我今天见到香肠帮忙给咱同胞了，杨总说过我祝你帮忙赚了几十的。过年看着忙不过去，几十到处去寻去，老表小叔送给他帮忙拾的，我这人个人赚不着，这不能挣钱不就像是你为这边的。之前我就老早老早了，都做星期六、星期三、星期六、星期三、八天的八天早上都忙，我都做这人个人赚不着，这不能挣钱不就像是你为这边的。之前我就老早了。虽然听说星期六、星期三、星期六、星期三、八天的八天，早上他们我都做了这种个人赚钱的，这不能挣钱不就像是你们这些的，这钱我就拿走了。虽然听说星期六、星期三、星期六、星期三、八天的八天，早上他们我都做了忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾。我忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东，忙活半天，个人帮忙拾。我忙活半天，个人帮忙拾东。我接拉到江苏了，带兵的到苏杭的那边，在江苏那当我帮他做些活的，就当抓紧别人咋的说，穷屯的广播家伙那样拉响咋了。那个楼主正你正着你的难道老三请你动个十三十七人你记得个老老王在那个那这笔做了马人们都等我的解释跟喇叭就打这样老主将等送这都是接着你摸你摸你接着着等着马人们在这等我的那个将你将这拉着呢等你到这三品的送人的你走接这的我是朝知道是你沿着道路门虽然将我老杨拦得的最终的基金接着我虽然道路的门门把着在你可当当就用路都把路主不必那我接得说娘姐前不走的你没想送你梦前不安家把个人当安装都什么都能把自己将来想在了。
各位法师，各位道友，大家下午好。
Good afternoon,
all teachers and other friends here today. 阿弥陀佛。非常感谢。明月居士林支持今天我们的法会。
I'm very grateful for the Bright Moon Dharma Center supporting this afternoon's teaching.
在这个地方，我们佛教有一个这么非常好的道场，感到非常的高兴。
To come here today and see such a wonderful Dharma Center, Dharma facility, I feel very happy.
那么有一个这么好的道场的话，那么道场的所在的这个意义是什么呢？就是给大家提供一个讲经说法、文字修心的平台。
And of course, the purpose of having a Dharma center is to provide a platform or a space for the study, reflection, and practice of the Dharma teachings.
那么有一个这么好的道场的话，那么这个道场里面呢，可能有经常都有一些佛事活动，这个我具体的不是很了解，但是应该是有一些佛事活动。
I'm not fully sure exactly what kind of activities are carried out here, but I gather there are various kinds of Buddhist assemblies.
那么佛教的寺庙，或者是佛教的，比如是像我们今天这样子的居士林啊，或者是佛教的中心啊，这些的存在的实际的意义是什么呢？就是给大家。传播佛陀的智慧和传播佛陀的慈悲心。
Whether it be monasteries or dharma centers, the whole reason for their existence is to provide a space for the spreading of the Buddha teachings, the wisdom of the Buddha, and the compassion of the Buddha.
在西方任何一个城市任何一个大学里面都可以看到一些非常非常壮观的教堂但是呢要看到一个佛教的比较规模稍微大一点的道场是很难的。
In the West, in big cities or in universities, it's quite common to see very stately churches, buildings in the Christian tradition. It's rather rare, however, to see a Buddhist building or facility of grand proportions.
那么今天就是有一个这么好的道场然后就是在这个道场当中有机会给大家交流跟大家分享感到很高兴。
So today to come to this wonderful facility, this wonderful space, and to have the opportunity to exchange, engage in interaction with everybody here, I feel very glad indeed.
同时非常的随喜居士林的林章虽然不在但是居士林的林章还有就是其他的负责人员付出了很多很多的心血建立了一个这样子的道场。
And I very much rejoice in the merit of the organizers and leaders of the Bright Moon community for the efforts they made to establish this place.
接下来我们讲今天的课。那么今天的课，我觉得我们今天在座的可能是90%左右，应该都是佛教徒。然后可能也许有不是佛教徒的其他的对佛教感兴趣或者是对佛陀的智慧感兴趣的人。
So, we're going to move on to this afternoon's teaching now. Looking at the audience, I'd say that probably about 90% of people here today are Buddhists, and the remaining 10% is probably people who are interested in Buddhism or otherwise interested in learning about the wisdom of the Buddha.
是不是佛教徒都没有关系的佛陀的智慧佛陀的慈悲是我们全人类的共同的资源共享的资源。
But it doesn't matter whether or not you are Buddhist or not. The Buddha Dharma, the teachings of the Buddhist tradition are a common resource of all humanity.
佛教的智慧当中我们每一个人比如说有信仰的没有信仰的有信仰当中比如说信仰基督的信仰其他的宗教的每一个人可以在佛教的智慧当中找到一些自己想找到的东西。
Whether or not an individual has faith in the Buddhist tradition or not, it's possible for everyone to find within the Buddha's wisdom things that they are searching for.
那么我们佛教徒他学习佛法然后呢修佛法他的目的是什么呢目的就是为了成佛我们每一个人都为了成佛来学习来修心。
For Buddhists, our main objective in studying the Dharma and practicing the Dharma is to attain Buddhahood.
那么佛是什么呢？佛不是身，佛就是一个人。
When we refer to the Buddha, we don't mean a god or a deity. The Buddha refers to a person.
然后释迦牟尼佛也不是完能的，但是呢，他不是全能、完能但是他是全知。
And while the Sakyamuni Buddha was not omnipotent, he certainly was all-knowing, omniscient.
然后我们今天在座的每一个人都有机会成佛，成为佛的果位，我们每一个人都可以达到佛的境界。
Every single person sitting here today has the opportunity or the potential to attain the level of Buddhahood, the same as the Buddha.
这个世界上啊，不是只有一个佛，可以有很多很多的佛。
There is not just one Buddha in the world. Indeed, there are very many.
这些佛以不同的身份，以不同的方式在利益众生帮助众生。
And the various Buddhas in the world take different forms and benefit other beings in different ways.
我们的社会的最底层的人当中也有佛，然后呢，动物当中也有佛，但是他们的身份就是不是高高在上的但是他们都是佛。
The lower stratas of society also have Buddhas, and there are also Buddhas among animals as well. While there are Buddhas in these various realms, they are not of a very conspicuous nature.
然后什么是佛呢？我们人类的智慧和慈悲心就这两个就大到巅峰的时候，也就是大到最高点最高的这个点就叫做佛。
And when we talk about the Buddha or a person being a Buddha, we're referring to someone whose compassion and wisdom has reached its highest potential.
我们每一个人都有智慧，我们每一个人都有慈悲心，只不过我们的慈悲心和我们的智慧没有佛的智慧和慈悲那么的伟大而已。
Every one of us has compassion and every one of us has wisdom. The difference between our compassion and wisdom and the Buddha's, however, is that our compassion and wisdom has not reached such mighty and elevated levels.
但是我们每一个人的智慧和我们每一个人的慈悲是可以训练的，可以训练，训练了以后呢，通过一种特殊的方法来训练，训练以后可以达到最高的境界达到了最高的境界的时候呢，就叫做成佛。
However, it's possible for us to train our compassion and train our wisdom, and by applying special practices to train and increase our compassion and wisdom until they reach their fullest potential. And in reaching their fullest potential, this is what we mean when we talk about attaining Buddhahood.
然后大乘佛教它的最终极的目标是什么呢？我们为什么要来学习呢？我们为什么要建这么大的庙呢？然后我们为什么要去天天去念佛呢？我们为什么要去磕头呢？
In terms of the Mahayana teachings, what are their ultimate objectives, or what is their ultimate objective? Why is it that we study the Dharma? Why would we build a Dharma center as big as this? Why do we recite the sutras?
它的终极的目标是什么？这个我们作为一个学佛的人来说，必须要明白。首先，必须要明白我们学佛的终极的目标。
To be a student of Buddhism, the most important thing, or the first thing we need to understand, is what our ultimate goal is.
那么我们很多人会想，我们很多人会说，我们的大乘佛教的终极的目标是成佛大乘佛教的终极目标就是成佛。其实不是最终极的目标不是成佛。
Many people say that the ultimate goal of the Mahayana tradition is the attainment of Buddhahood.
那么最终极的目标不是成佛，那是什么呢？就是利益更多的众生，也就是佛教讲的普度众生利益更多的众生。我们的最终极的目标是能够帮助天下所有的众生，这就是大乘佛教的学佛的终极的目标。
However, this in fact is not our ultimate objective. Our ultimate objective as students of the Mahayana tradition is to benefit other beings, to be of greatest benefit possible to all beings, and this is what our ultimate objective is.
虽然我们的终极的目标不是成佛，但是这个终极的目标要大到这个终极的目标，那就是要成佛的。如果我们不成佛，我们现在没有能力去帮助天下所有的众生。只有我们成了佛，只有我们成了像释迦牟尼佛这样子的佛，才能够更好的去帮助所有的众生。
Even though attaining Buddhahood is not our ultimate objective, it's still necessary that we do this in order that we might be able to fulfill our ultimate goal of benefiting other beings. As we currently are, we don't have a highly developed capacity to benefit other beings. It's through attaining Buddhahood that we will be able to do so most effectively.
所以我们还是要成佛啊！终极的目标不是成佛，而是度众生。但是度众生不成佛，没有办法度；不成佛，没有能力去度。所以呢，最后我们还是要选择成佛。
But because without attaining Buddhahood ourselves, we lack the ability, we lack the capacity to liberate other beings, it is necessary that we ourselves first attain Buddhahood.
那么，怎么样成佛？这个是最最重要了。我们怎么样能够成佛呢？大乘佛教的目标是帮助众生、利益众生啊，利益众生的方法是成佛。那我们怎么样成佛呢？成佛的方法是什么？具体的方法是什么？这个就是我们今天要讲的课。
So it's necessary as students of the Mahayana tradition to attain Buddhahood. But how do we go about doing this? What practices do we use to attain Buddhahood? This is what we are going to address in this afternoon's teaching.
首先我们要相信我们每一个人都有佛的种子啊，佛的种子就在我们的心里。然后呢，我们把这个种子培养啊，培养的话，最后一定会开花结果。我们必须要相信这一点。
The first thing that all of us need to have faith in is that we all possess the seed of Buddhahood within us, just like the seed of a flower. And by nurturing this seed, it is possible that it will eventually flower into full Buddhahood.
那么，这个种子叫什么呢？种子就叫佛心。
And the name of this seed of Buddhahood is Buddha nature.
佛心就是我们原本我们就有慈悲心，然后我们就有智慧，只不过我们的智慧和我们的慈悲心还没有达到佛的境界而已。实际上我们都已经有智慧和慈悲心。
In terms of compassion and wisdom, these are things that we already possess. We possess them intrinsically. As of yet, however, they haven't reach the same levels of maturity as the Buddhas.
简单的说，这个就是佛的种子。比如说，我们一粒米就播下去了以后呢，然后如果有温度、有湿度、有空间、有时间这样子的话，那这个种子慢慢会发芽，最后会成长。
So it's just the same as planting a seed in the ground. As long as we have the conditions of an appropriate temperature, we have time, space, the appropriate moisture, etc., then it is guaranteed that this seed will sprout.
那么这两个智慧和慈悲，我们怎么样去培养啊？怎么样把它让它成长啊？怎么样让它增长？怎么让它发展到佛的程度啊？这个就是要我们所学的内容。
So what the main topic of our study is how to take our seeds of compassion and wisdom and grow them, increase them, develop them to full Buddhahood.
今天我们全世界的所有的这个东方和西方很多所有佛教徒当中大部分的人大部分的人就是不怎么去学习和修心。
These days, among the Buddhists in the world, whether they be from the East or the West, the majority of people don't, in fact, study the Dharma teachings and engage in their practice.
那么大部分的人没有学习，没有修行，那么在干什么呢？我们绝大多数的人就是所谓的学佛是什么呢？就是我们的目标是为了精神为了精神的健康、长寿、发财，然后就是工作顺利这是我们的目标，我们的学佛的目标，而不是我们的学佛的目标是成佛呀、利益众生啊，不是，就是为了健康长寿。
So if the vast majority of people are not studying and practicing the Dharma, then what are they doing? Well, what they are doing is engaging in Buddhist activities with their goals being things such as health, prosperity, good luck, etc. in this life.
然后我们的方法是什么呢？不是学习，不是打坐，不是修心，而我们的方法是烧香、拜佛、磕头、念经，这些都是我们的方法。
And rather than having as their methods the study and practice of Buddhism, meditation, etc., the practices or the methods that such worldly-oriented Buddhists engage in are things like making incense offerings, doing prostrations, recitations of the Buddha's name, etc.
如果我们一切都是为了今生，一切都是为了现实生活的话，那我们就没有必要学佛了。
If in fact all of our endeavors are for benefits in this life, then in fact there is really not much use in studying Buddhism.
我们今生的名利发财等等这个我们不学佛也可以的，唯物论者唯心唯物论者无神论者，他一样的可以过一个很好的生活。
If our objectives are things like wealth and fame and prestige, etc., then there's no need for us to study Buddhism. In fact, atheists and agnostics, they too can enjoy existences that are rich in these regards.
如果我们的学佛的目标所有的学佛的目标就是锁定在一个很小很小的范围这个范围就是为了精神的健康、精神的利益、名和利，这样子的话，这种学佛不是大乘佛教，也不是小乘佛教，都不是。
If our goal in being Buddhist is restricted to an extremely limited scope, one that is oriented towards our own personal interests and advantage in this life, then this scope of motivation is far from meeting the standard of the Mahayana teachings. It also falls short of the standard of the Hinayana teachings.
为什么不是大乘佛教、小乘佛教呢？大乘佛教、小乘佛教都是让我们超越轮回让我们解决生老病死的问题。小乘佛教就是为了解决自己的生老病死的问题学佛，大乘佛教呢，就是为了天下所有众生的解脱而学佛。这个里面呢，没有一个是为了今生的名和利学习修行，所以这种学佛既不是大乘，又不是小乘。
The reason that Buddhism oriented towards attaining worldly benefits in this life doesn't satisfy the standards of either the Mahayana or Hinayana traditions is because that both of these teachings, the greater vehicle and the modest vehicle, are oriented towards achieving liberation from cyclic existence, transcending the sufferings of samsara. Neither in the Mahayana teachings or the Hinayana teachings is there the valid goal of simply working for benefits in this life. In the Mahayana teachings, we work for the liberation of all sentient beings, and in the Hinayana teachings, we work for our own personal liberation.
我们为了今生的健康长寿发财烧香拜佛念经磕头这样子的学佛，实际上根本就不是学佛。
If we engage in our main Buddhist practice is to do such things as recitations, prostrations, incense offerings for the sake of benefits in this life, wealth, prosperity, long life, etc., then in actual fact this is not being a genuine student of Buddhism.
那么这个不叫学佛，那这叫什么呢？这个就叫做供佛。
We can't describe this kind of conduct as the study of Buddhism. If we had to give it a name, it would be making offerings to the Buddha or supplication.
然后当我们遇到一些灾难或者是遇到一些困难的时候，我们到庙里去烧香，然后呢求佛祖的保佑，佛祖来保佑我健康长寿，度过这个难关等等，这种方法呢也不叫学佛，这个就叫做求佛。
And if when we encounter misfortune or calamity, we go to the temple and supplicate the Buddha to tide us through this period of bad luck, then this simile is not studying Buddhism, it's making requests of the Buddha.
那么什么是学佛呢？学佛就是向释迦牟尼佛的智慧向释迦牟尼佛学习，就叫做学佛。
So what is it then to study Buddhism? Well, studying Buddhism is to follow and to study the example of the Buddha.
向释迦牟尼佛学习，学习什么呢？就是两个，第一个向释迦牟尼佛的智慧学习。第二个，向释迦牟尼佛的慈悲心学习。
In what respects do we study the Buddha or the Buddha's example? There are only two, the Buddha's wisdom and the Buddha's compassion.
除了这两个以外，没有，就这两个。
Aside from these two things, there are no others.
我们每一个人都会希望自己幸福、健康、长寿不仅是我们自己，而且我们的家人、亲戚、朋友大家都是幸福、快乐这个有没有错？这当然是没有错的。
Of course, everybody hopes for themselves that they be healthy, happy, and have a long life. Everyone hopes the same thing for those around them, their family members.Is there anything wrong with this? Well, of course, no, there's nothing wrong with it.
然后我们为了这些可不可以去做一些善事呢？也可以的。
And can we, in order to reach these goals or assist in these goals, engage in positive and meritorious conduct? Yes, we can.
那么什么不可以呢？如果我们的整个的学佛的目标也就是这么一点点，这样子的话，那我们这个就不叫学佛。
However, what we can't do is make these things the entirety of our goals in studying Buddhism.
我们学大乘佛教，为别人着想，为一切众生着想，这样子的话，我们自己的健康长寿这些不需要我们不需要专门去想这些事情，这些事情呢会自然而然就会该有的都会有的。
As students of the Mahayana teachings, striving for the well-being of all beings, it's not necessary for us to work specifically for our own happiness and health. In the course of our practice, these things will take care of themselves automatically.
今天我们在座的都有各种各样的人有各种各样的层次的人我们不一定每个人都是很有钱的人不一定每个人都是很贫穷的人不一定我们每一个人都是文化水平很高的人不一定都是很低的人但是这些都没关系从学佛的角度来讲我们每一个人都有一个非常非常非常非常非常非常好的机会和选择
Everybody here today no doubt represents a diversity of circumstances. Some people very well off, some people not well off, some people with a high level of education, some people with a not particularly high level of education, but none of this actually matters. From the point of view of Buddhism, everybody here today possesses a wonderful choice, a wonderful chance.
释迦牟尼佛在佛经里面经常讲人生难得，佛法难闻。
In the Buddhist scriptures, it is frequently said how precious this human life is and how rare the opportunity to hear the teachings.
在我们的整个的这个生命轮回的过程当中，我们的这一次，我们的这一生，是一个非常非常关键的一段时间。
In the course of our countless existences, this current one, where we have the human birth, is a very, very vital juncture.
也是非常有价值非常有意义的一段时间。
It's a period of time that has great meaning. It's an extremely precious period of time.
那么这个时候呢，我们学佛的目标应该要我们要设定一个比较高一点的学佛的目标。我们的目标不要太低了我们的目标是为了健康，为了长寿。这样子的话这个学佛的目标是实在是非常非常的低，非常的世俗，非常的庸俗。
So it's during this very precious window of time that we should strive to make our goals in studying Buddhism, setting them as high as we can. If our goal in practicing Buddhism or in being a Buddhist is simply to attain worldly benefits in this life, then this is really too low a goal to have set ourselves. It's a very common, vulgar kind of aspiration.
那么我们应该有一个什么样的目标呢我们第一个我们就是要向我要帮助天下所有的众生我要利益天下所有的众生不仅仅是人类不仅仅是我们这个地球上的人类天下所有的生命天下所有的生命我要去帮助他们就是要需要有一颗这样子的心。
Rather, what we need is to cultivate the aspiration to benefit all living beings, all beings everywhere in the entire universe. It's this aspiration to benefit them, to help them, that we should be working on cultivating.
我们应该有一个，我一定要让天下所有的众生远离一切痛苦我要去做这件事应该有这样子的勇气和发心这个就叫做大悲心
We should be working on cultivating the courageous aspiration to assist all living beings in being free from suffering and it's this motivation, this aspiration that is what we refer to as great compassion
还有就是我要让天下所有的众生拥有一切幸福我要让天下所有的众生拥有幸福 要发这样子的心，这个心叫做慈心，叫做大慈心，这两个叫做大慈大悲。
And in addition to the aspiration that to assist in helping all living beings from be free from suffering, we should also be working on the aspiration that to help in leading all beings to attain every kind of happiness. And it's these two together, these two aspirations.That form the overall great compassion, which is the standard of the Mahayana teachings.
这个大慈大悲，它不分国界，它不分种族，不分宗教的信仰，凡是人，凡是生命啊，都要发这样子的慈悲心啊。凡是生命，我都要去帮助，我都要去利益他们。我都要让他们去，我要让他们离苦得乐啊！首先，我们学佛的学大乘佛教的前提的条件就是这样子，我们要怀着一颗这样子的心来进入佛门。
So this great compassion is a quality that does not entertain distinctions based on nationality or ethnicity or religious background. It is an aspiration, it's a motivation, a quality that applies equally to all beings everywhere. And it is cultivating this aspiration that is the first thing we should really work on as students entering into the Mahayana path.
那么我们怎么让天下所有的众生离苦得乐吗？这不就是一个妄想吗？我们哪有这样子的能力呢？那大家要相信我们自己的力量。我们目前是没有这样子的力量，但是呢，我们有一种方法可以达到这个目标。
Leading all beings from suffering and helping them attain every kind of happiness. Is this, in fact, an unrealizable dream? It's necessary that everyone have belief in their potential in this regard.
那么方法是什么呢？方法就是首先我自己成佛啊，首先我要成佛。我成佛了以后呢，我才能够让更多的人成佛。我这样子以后呢，我们才能够实现我们的这个梦想。
In terms of actually how we go about doing this, our method, our path is to attain Buddhahood ourselves. And it's through doing this that we will be in a position that we will be equipped to engage in the work of benefiting others.
大乘佛教的目标，大乘佛教的梦想，大乘佛教的理想是什么呢？就是让天下所有的众生离苦得乐，他的一切都是为了这个奋斗。
The ideal dream and the ultimate goal of the Mahayana teachings is that all beings be free from suffering and enjoy every happiness.
但是我们刚刚学佛的时候呢，非常非常不容易，我们有一颗这样子的心啊，很难，很难的。但这个没关系，我们可以一步一步的去，可以训练啊，训练了以后呢，最后我们真的会有一个这样子的梦想，一定会有的。
That we might naturally or effortlessly have this aspiration at the beginning of our studies of Buddhism is probably not very likely. It's difficult to cultivate. However, it is certainly possible by training ourselves that we will be able to cultivate a genuine aspiration.
这个梦想叫做菩提心。这叫做菩提心请大家要记住这三个字，菩提心就是大乘佛教的精华。
It's this aspiration that the word bodhicitta refers to, and indeed bodhicitta is the essence of the Mahayana teachings.
菩提心就是大乘佛教的灵魂，没有菩提心就是没有大乘佛教。
The bodhicitta is the soul of Mahayana practice. Without it, there would be, in fact, no Mahayana path.
大乘佛教的所有的付出、所有的功德啊、所有的心善啊，都要建立在啊这个菩提心的基础上。
In the Mahayana tradition, all of the positive and meritorious conduct that we engage in, all of our efforts take place on a foundation of bodhicitta.
然后这个有这个菩提心的话，那我们烧香、拜佛、诵经、磕头等等啊，所有的这些都成为大乘佛教。
And if we have this aspiration, then engaging in activities such as making offerings, lighting incense, doing recitations, prostrating, etc., then all of these activities will become activities in accordance with the aspiration of the Mahayana tradition.
那么这一生当中呢，我们有一个非常好的机会，我们大家都有机会去学习菩提心。我们大家都有机会去修菩提心，去训练这个菩提心，这个真的是千载难逢的机会。
That each of us in this lifetime has the opportunity to study bodhicitta and to practice bodhicitta, to train in bodhicitta. This really is a once in a blue moon opportunity.
释迦牟尼佛之所以说人生难得，就是因为有这么好的机会，所以就是说啊，经常佛经里面经常提到人生难得。
It's on account of this reason, the rareness and preciousness of the opportunity to practice the Dharma, that the Buddha frequently described this human rebirth as being as precious as it was.
我们应该啊，从烧香拜佛啊，从这个为了个人的利益，从为了个人的健康长寿烧香拜佛，从这里专入为了天下所有的众生啊，学习修心大作啊，这样子我们应该要专入。
So we should endeavor to transform our objectives.Say in making incense offerings and making other offerings for our own sake, for our own health, for our own prosperity, we should seek to transform our objectives instead to the benefit and attaining of Buddhahood of all living beings.
那么具体的方法是什么呢？请大家要记住三个字，这个三个字就是具体的方法。
And in terms of how we should go about this, there are three words that everyone should bear in mind.
这三个字是什么呢？叫做闻、思、修。
And these three words are hearing, reflecting, and practicing.
闻就是听闻佛法啊，因为我们现在不知道啊，什么是佛法？我们不知道怎么样去学习，不知道怎么样去修心，怎么样去打坐。我们不知道我们的这些烦恼怎么样去控制啊。我们不知道怎么样能够更好的去帮助众生，这一切我们都不知道。所以我们要去听，所以我们要去学。
So the first word hearing refers to, or listening refers to hearing the Buddha's teachings, hearing the teachings of the Dharma. At present, we don't know the content of the Dharma, the teachings, we don't know how to go about Buddhist practice, we don't necessarily know how to really go about benefiting all beings in the most effective way. So it's for this reason that we need to listen, hear the teachings of the Buddha.
我们天下的所有的人或者所有的生命都在追求幸福，但是我们得不到幸福，我们不想衰老啊，不想老也得要衰老， 不想死也得要死亡不想生病也得要这个生病。那么这些是为什么？这些原因是什么呢？我们为什么是这样子呢？这个也得要去学习。
All humans and indeed all beings similarly pursue happiness. However, attaining happiness is something that doesn't come easily. None of us, for example, want to face death, and yet we all inevitably have to do this. None of us want to age. None of us want to become sick. However, these are things that we will all inevitably have to confront.
然后我们更不知道怎么样去解决这些烦恼。比如说，我们每一个人都有嗔恨心，有抱怨，有仇恨，生气，然后有这个过度的欲望，然后我们又不明白我们自己的这个生命的真相。人生的真相，我们有太多太多不了解的东西。那么这些问题怎么样解决？我们都不知道，所以我们要去学习。首先，我们要去听佛陀怎么讲，佛教怎么讲，我们要先去听。这个叫做闻。
And in respect of our disturbed negative emotional states.These are also things that we don't have really much idea of how we can go about overcoming, whether it be hatred or anger, attachment. These are things that we all battle with. Similarly, we don't have a proper understanding of the truth of the external world or even ourselves. So it's in order to increase our understanding or our wisdom in relation to all of these things that it is necessary we study the Buddha's teachings.
但是我们非常遗憾的是什么呢？我们最大的遗憾就是我们佛教徒不怎么去听不怎么去学这些我们就为了自己的健康长寿烧香拜佛而已，我们什么都不知道。这个是我们不懂得去学习我们佛教里面有这么完善的、这么好的一个教育，一个非常非常系统的教育，但是我们不去学习，这个是最大的遗憾。
But it's a great pity indeed, a great shame indeed that many Buddhists have no idea how comprehensive and systematic the Buddhist teachings are in respect of helping us to overcome these situations, and instead they spend their time engaging in various activities, making offerings, etc., for their own worldly objectives. This situation is a great pity indeed.
从佛教的角度，从佛教的角度来讲，我们绝大多数的佛教徒都是文盲，我们根本就不知道佛教里面讲什么。
We could say, in fact, that the vast majority of Buddhists are illiterate. The vast majority of Buddhists have no real idea, in fact, what the content of the Buddhist teachings are.
但是我们自以为是我们以为烧香拜佛就是佛教的全部的内容，其实这个就是最大的错误，这个不是佛教的全部的内容。
But many of us nevertheless think that making offerings and lighting incense is in fact the totality of the Buddhist tradition. This, however, is far from the truth.
所以我们希望，我们呼吁佛教徒不要停留在这个烧香拜佛的这个层面上，大家要超越突破这个层面。
So I very much hope and I urge everyone not to get stuck at this level, to transcend this level and of practice and scope of motivation.
这是第一个，第二个叫做闻，以后呢叫做思，思就是思考。
So the first of this threefold formula is to listen or hear. The second thing we need to do is reflect or contemplate.
佛教里面讲的很多都是非常非常深奥的道理这个我们光是听一下 不一定能够理解，不一定能够消化，所以呢，我们听完了以后呢，要进一步的去思考这个问题。
Since many of the Buddhist teachings are extremely deep and profound in nature, simply listening to them might not be enough for us to gain a proper understanding or to be able to digest them properly. So it's for this reason that we need to reflect and contemplate on the teachings we have heard.
在这个思考的过程当中，佛教欢迎大家有更多的疑问啊，或者是有不同的声音，或者是有相反的观点啊，有更多的疑问，有更多的怀疑。不但是允许有这样子的怀疑和疑问啊，而且佛教鼓励大家有更多的疑问。这样子以后呢，我们有很多很多很多疑问以后呢，我们就是为了寻找啊，为了解决这个问题，我们会去寻找这个答案啊。那么这样子以后呢，我们在佛教里面一定能够找到这个答案，最后啊，可以把我们的这些疑问都可以啊解决。所以佛教非常的欢迎大家啊，在这个思考的过程当中有各种各样的疑问。
And during this process of reflection and contemplation, the Buddhist tradition not only permits people to or students to ask all kinds of questions and manifest all kinds of doubts, but in fact encourages this. It's through having doubts and asking questions that we are really motivated to search for the answers. And it is certainly the case that by asking questions, we will, and diligently pursuing the answers, that we will find them in the Buddhist tradition. In any case, it is highly encouraged that we ask all kinds of questions during this stage of reflection.
佛教认为我们啊听了佛教以后，然后有度力去思考这到底是还是不是啊，这样反复的思考，然后在这个思考的过程当中提出更多更多的这个问题，还有就是提出相反的观点啊，这样子以后呢，经过了很多的这个思考和观察，最终啊得到佛陀的这个智慧，这个叫做佛教认为啊，这个就叫做知性啊，叫做知性，就是一种智慧的心性啊，通过智慧最终获得了一种信仰，这就是跟普通的信仰是不一样的。
The Buddha considered a process of investigation and examination into his teachings with raising lots of doubts and raising opposing opinions would lead ultimately to a faith that was founded on the basis of wisdom. And a wisdom-informed faith is entirely different in nature to a faith, a religious faith that is not founded on a foundation of rational investigation, analysis, and reflection.
我们啊不学习不观察啊，就是盲目的去相信的话，那么这个就是叫做迷信啊，不是佛教佛陀不太喜欢啊。这样子的人，释迦牟尼佛他不是喜欢一开始就相信他自己的人啊，释迦牟尼佛就是喜欢真理，喜欢真相的，相信真相的人啊，并不是喜欢他相信他自己的人。
So a faith that is not based on a process of investigation and analysis and observation is a blind faith, and the Buddha does not endorse this kind of faith. The Buddha prefers people who believe in the nature of truth. They believe in reality. The Buddha is not looking for people who believe in everything his teachings espouse from the very first moment.
我们今天的现实生活当中产生的各种各样的压力、焦虑、抑郁、 各种各样的痛苦啊，都是因为我们相不同、相不开啊、不了解啊这样子的情况下产生的。如果我们相通了、相开了啊，很多这些问题的话，那么我们的生活当中不会有这么多的啊痛苦。
Much of the pressure and anxiety and negative emotional states we experience these days is based on us lacking a proper understanding of their nature. If we were to have a clear understanding, then these situations, negative situations, would resolve themselves.
佛教它可以帮助所有的人。可以帮助不同信仰的人，他可以帮助，甚至可以帮助无神论者，但是我们现在不学习不去思考这样子的话，那么不但是不能帮助其他人，连我们自己学佛的人，佛教徒自己都不能帮助自己。
The Buddhist teachings have the capacity to be of benefit to everyone, not only Buddhists, but also people of different religious faiths and indeed those without any religious faith at all. However, if we don't study the teachings, if we don't learn their content, then the Buddhist teachings won't even be able to benefit ourselves.
比如说我们烧香拜佛一辈子当我们跟其他人一样的姿势呀，我们有些时候呢还不如无神论者啊，有些时候我们还不如这个唯物论者呀那么我们一样的自私，我们烧香拜佛了一辈子，我们还是有这么自私我们烧香拜佛一辈子，我们还这么小小的问题上斤斤计较，我们烧香拜佛了一辈子，念佛念了一辈子，还有抱怨，还有仇恨，那么这个跟没有学佛的人什么不一样？没有什么不一样。
If we spend our entire lives just making offerings and lighting incense with our own priorities at the forefront, then we are in no way better or different from anyone else, anyone, a person without any religious belief at all. Similarly, if we've been reciting the Buddha's name and engaging in other dharmic activities for an entire lifetime, but we still get worked up over very small attitudes and find ourselves deluded by our negative emotions, then ultimately there is not much difference between us as Buddhists and anybody else either.
那我们烧香烧了一辈子，念佛念了一辈子，拜佛拜了一辈子那么最终我们的知识，我们的烦恼还没有解决，是不是佛法的问题？不是佛法的问题，而是我们学佛的方法不对，我们的学佛的方法错了，所以我们学佛了一辈子，最终我们看不到结果。
Is the fact though that we have been followers of the Buddhism for a lifetime and not really seen any clear results. Is this the fault of the Buddha's teachings or is it the fault of ourselves? Well, clearly it's the fault of ourselves because without studying the content of the teachings, it's very difficult to put it into practice.
所以我们要去思考，要去学习学习思考这样子的话，然后我们明白很多很多的人生的道理是我们明白了很多很多的真相，这样子以后呢，我们很多问题我们相通了、相开了以后呢，很多的这些痛苦焦虑自然就会消失。
It's by studying the teachings and reflecting on them that much of the negative emotions we experience, pressure, anxiety, etc., will resolve itself naturally.
然后我们有些人认为学佛是老年人的事情年轻人就不应该去学佛，不需要学佛其实完全是错了。为什么呢？我们以为烧香拜佛念佛磕头才是学佛这样子的话，那么这些都是老年人去做的事情 其实不是学佛，就是学智慧啊，学慈悲心。嗯，慈悲心年轻人为什么不需要呢？智慧年轻人为什么不需要呢？现在的学校大学的50%、45%左右这样子的人学生都有很大的压力，所以他们的精神上有很多很多的精神疾病，比如说抑郁症等等很多。所以解决这些问题就是佛教的这个智慧，佛教的这个慈悲佛教的禅修的方法完全可以解决这些年轻人的心灵的痛苦。那么他们为什么不可以学习这些，为什么不可以用这些方法来解决自己的问题呢？
Another very common misconception is that Buddhism is for old people. This is very much not the case. And this mistaken idea comes about because most people consider the practice of Buddhism things such as reciting the Buddha's name and making offerings, etc. However, this is not the entire contents of the Buddhist tradition. Really, the essence of the Buddha's teaching is wisdom and compassion. And these are things that young people are in need of equally as those who are older. For example, these days there are many students, university students, perhaps upwards of 40% who find themselves under great pressure, experiencing depression itself. The Buddha's teachings, the Buddha's compassion, wisdom, meditation techniques are all capable of bringing great relief to such young people. Therefore, Buddhism is something that is equally appropriate and necessary for those who are younger in age.
然后有些人觉得学佛是过去的人，大家都是普遍的文化水平比较低这样子的时候，就是古人的这个思考的方式现代人每一个都是文化水平很高，有了科技让我们明白很多很多道理，这个时候不需要学佛但是这个是最大的错误，因为我们现代人的心灵的疾病比过去的人比古人的多几十倍这样子的时候呢，我们的内心当中的这些痛苦呢，哲学不能解决，科学不能解决，所以我们现代人是更加的需要学佛学习。
Another mistaken idea is that Buddhism is something for people of ancient times or people of the past who had low levels of educational attainment. Many people think that nowadays in modern times we have science, we have technology, so we don't need the Buddha's teachings. However, this is also very much far from the truth. Our current age is one in which we have an unprecedented level of mental illness and disorder. So it is one in which we are more than ever needing of the wisdom of the Buddhist tradition.
但是我们把学佛理解为烧香拜佛的话，那真的是年轻人有没有这个必要，然后现代人有没有这个必要，就是值得思考的。
However, if we understand Buddhism simply to be lighting incense and doing recitations on our prayer beads, then yes, we do need to ask whether this is something that young people are in need of.
好，这个就是第二个层面，我们要去思考要去思考。听完了以后呢，光是听还不行，要进一步的去思考，这是第二个阶段。
So we first listen to the teachings, we learn the teachings, second, we reflect on them.
第三就叫做修，闻思修第三就是修。这三个当中，我们最终我们最需要的，或者是真正的能够解决我们的问题的，就是修。
And then the third stage is practice or meditation. And this is the stage that is most capable or really capable of solving our difficulties.
修是什么呢？修就是打坐修就是一种精神上的训练，就是心灵的训练。 就像我们一个这么自私的人啊，有这么烦恼的人，通过一种训练的方式，逐渐逐渐的训练，把我们的啊这些所有的负面的这些情绪，像抱怨、仇恨啊，这个还有就是贪欲啊，还有我们的愚昧啊等等这些东西摧毁啊，通过一种方法把这些摧毁啊，这个过程叫做修心。
So when we talk about practice, what we are referring to is meditation or a kind of psychological training, one in which we eliminate our negative emotional states, our afflictions, afflictions that include anger, greed, hatred, ignorance, etc. The process, the mental process of training with the result of eliminating these mental states is what we refer to as practice.
除了摧毁我们的烦恼以外，还有增长我们的慈悲心啊，增长我们的这个智慧。我们通过一种方法去培养啊，培养我们的慈悲心，培养我们的智慧。这个过程啊，就叫做修心。
And in addition to eliminating our negative and disturbed mental states, practice also entails increasing and developing our compassion and wisdom.
希望我们啊，佛教徒就是学佛，首先我们最起码也要懂得什么叫做学佛，这个我觉得是非常重要。
I hope that everyone, indeed all Buddhists, have a correct understanding of what it means actually to be a student of Buddhism. This is very important.
我们每一个人的时间啊，学佛的时间啊，不一定是很多啊，因为每一个人都有很多很多自己的工作啊、生活等等啊方面要花很多的时间。但是呢，我们每一天啊，应该是可以基础啊一点点的时间，比如说40分钟、一个小时啊，这样子的时间是我们应该是可以安排的。
Many of us don't have much leftover time in our busy schedules. We've got busy work lives, busy personal lives. However, it's probably possible that everyone is able to extract at least 40 minutes or an hour of their time every day.
我们每个人啊，一周当中的5天啊，每天都要花8个小时的时间去上班啊，挣钱，就是为了生存。但是呢，除了8个小时以外，还有2个8个小时。
Everyone, in order to meet their needs of survival, have to spend 5 days each week working for 8 hours. However, in addition to these 8 hours spent each day working, we have another 8 hours that we can allocate otherwise.
这两个八个小时当中呢，我们比如说早上我们早起1个小时，在1个小时当中去打坐修心啊，然后晚上啊有安排1个小时或者是40分钟这样子的时间啊当中去打坐啊修心训练，这样子的话每天基本上有2个小时的打坐的时间啊，这样子时间啊这样子长时间这样子下来了以后呢，一定会有进步的。
If we are able to allocate an hour of time every morning to practice, to meditation, to training our minds, and then another hour later in the day, or 40 minutes, approximately 2 hours each day, if we're able to maintain this practice, then we are sure to see results over a period of time.
然后我们在这个2个小时当中到底修什么呢？什么是修心呢？啊，这个是今天我们要给大家讲的主体的课程，就是这个。
So what do we do? What should be the focus of our practice in these 2 hours? This is what I would like to address in this afternoon's teaching.
今天我们要讲的这个题目就是禅与密，也就是说禅宗和密宗。
The topic of this afternoon's teaching is the relationship between Chan and Tantra.
那我们在这个两个小时当中修什么呢？就是修禅，就是修密。
So essentially what we are doing during these 2 hours we allocate to practice each day is practice the teachings of the Chan tradition and the Tantric tradition.
韩传佛教的禅宗和藏传佛教的密宗那么这两个都是佛教里面的一个最高端的课程。
The teachings of the Chan lineage of Chinese Buddhism and the Vajrayana teachings are the most advanced level of teachings in the Buddhist tradition.
最高端的这个课程，我们要去修最高端的课程，前提的条件是什么？必须要有基础。如果没有基础，我们是没有办法去修这么高的这个。禅和密。
But the precondition of studying such advanced teachings, the teachings of the Chan tradition and the Vajrayana teachings, is that we have an appropriate foundation.
它的前提它的基础是什么呢？基础就是出离心跟菩提心，以及还有其他的这个基础的课程就是它的基础。
And this foundation is comprised of renunciation, bodhicitta, and several other things. These serve as the foundation for higher practice.
像禅宗汉传佛教的禅宗的六祖慧能大师就是一句《金刚经》当中的一句话就证悟了，开悟了那么我们。金刚经和心经念了一辈子也不开悟，这是为什么呢？
Why was it that the sixth Chan patriarch Hui Neng achieved enlightenment upon hearing one line from the Diamond Sutra? Why is it that we hearing the Diamond Sutra or the Heart Sutra many times over still aren't enlightened?
我们每一个人都可以成佛，从这个角度来讲，我们所有人都是平等的。
Everybody has exactly the same potential to become enlightened or to attain Buddhahood. In this respect, we are all equal.
但是我们的根基，有些人的根基非常的成熟的，有些人的根基还不成熟，这个确实是不一样的。
However, the level of preparedness and the capacity of different individuals, there is much difference and diversity in this regard.
那我们普通的人，我们根基不成熟的人，我们境界没有这么高的人，那怎么办呢？我们怎么能够达到六祖慧能大师的这样子的级别呢？有没有方法呢？方法有，我们从零开始，从最基础的一步一步的训练，就可以每一个人就可以达到像六祖慧能大师这样子的级别。
How do we as ordinary beings, beings whose preparation is not fully mature, go about attaining the same level of realization as the sixth patriarch Hui Neng? Well, the way that we do this is by beginning at zero and then working our way up gradually, step by step, until we too can attain the realization of Hui Neng.
根基的成熟是什么？比如说是一个非常好的土壤里面种庄稼，很快就会长出来的然后就是一个干燥的地方一个非常干燥的地方或者是在沙滩上种庄稼永远都是没有办法长，没有办法种，没有办法长。
In terms of our capacity or our preparedness for dharmic practice, we can understand this through the analogy of soil. A soil that is very healthy is very rich. If we plant a seed in it, the seed will grow very quickly. However, if the soil is arid, if the soil is dry, then we plant a seed in it and it will struggle to grow.
那我们怎么样把我们的心就变成一个非常好的土壤，非常好的土地这样子呢？就是通过这个最基本的训练，就是出离心跟菩提心，然后一步一步去修，这样子逐渐逐渐的，我们的心就变成一个非常好的土壤或者土地啊一样。这个时候我们去种庄稼，很快就很快就成熟，很快就会长出来的。
The way that we go about turning our own minds into a fertile soil for the Dharma teachings is by first working on the foundation of renunciation, cultivating bodhicitta, and then practicing step by step. Ultimately, by doing this, by making our minds fertile soil, planting a seed in our minds, the seed will grow and develop extremely quickly.
修心打坐啊，修心和打坐，这不仅仅是出家人啊，我们所有的普通人、在家人啊，一方面工作，一方面养家糊口，另一方面呢啊，可以修心，我们每一个人都可以修心的。
Buddhist practice and meditation are not just pursuits for monks, nuns, and ordained persons. These are things that people, lay people who hold down jobs, who support families, can and should equally engage in.
释迦牟尼佛说，佛法就像水一样，水我们任何人都需要水，富裕的人也需要水，贫穷的人也需要水啊，就是。有实力的人也需要水啊，没有实力的人也需要水，什么样的人都需要水，如果没有水，人没有办法生活。除了人以外，动物也是一样需要水。除了动物以外呢，植物也是需要水，如果没有水，动物、植物、人类都是没有办法生存。
The Buddha likened the Dharma to water. Everyone, regardless of whether they're rich, poor, powerful, or weak, similarly need water. Everyone needs water. Not only humans, but animals and plants also need water to survive.
所以佛教讲的慈悲心和智慧是我们每一个人都应该有慈悲心，每一个人都有应该有智慧，这是我们的今生的粮食。所以我们什么样的人，什么信仰的人，什么样的身份的人都适合这个佛教的这些修法，也就是说我们都应该去修这个慈悲心和智慧。
And likewise, the wisdom and compassion of the Buddhist tradition are things that everyone, in fact, is in need of.
首先啊，修什么？修出离心。
So the first thing we need to cultivate is renunciation.
出离心我们怎么修啊？藏传佛教里面呢？有一个叫做四加心，四加心，加心是什么意思呢？也叫做加心，也叫做前心，这是我们修禅、修密的前提的这个前面的预备的这个修行这个就叫做前心或者是加心。
We go about cultivating renunciation by practicing the preliminaries, the preliminary practices or the preparatory practices. These are our necessary preparation to higher levels of practice, such as those in the Chan and Vajrayana teachings.
那么这个加薪啊，就分两种加薪，一个叫做外加薪，另外一个叫做内加薪。
And we separate the preliminary practices into two categories. The first being the outer preliminaries, and the second being the inner preliminaries.
外加薪和内加薪的区别是什么？外加薪就是比较简单的啊啊，比较浅薄的。然后呢，内加薪呢是比较深入的。
And the distinction between the two is that the outer preliminaries are somewhat more simple and the inner preliminaries are more complex.
出离心是什么？什么叫做出离心？啊，我们刚刚讲了，我们现在的绝大部分的这个学佛的人，大多数的这个学佛的人啊，就是我们的目的是为了健康长寿、工作顺利啊，或者是再啊再稍微再想的远一点的话，那么下一世我同样的能够健康长寿发财啊，下一世我也可以做一个有权力的人、有钱的人啊、有地位的人啊，就是为了这一点学佛，这叫做没有出离心。没有出离心的话，就是这样子的。
So if we want to understand what it means not to have renunciation, then it would be, say, a person whose goal of Buddhist practice is simply to attain worldly benefits in this life, or somewhat beyond this, worldly benefits in their next life, in future rebirths. This is, this demonstrates a lack of renunciation.
那什么是出离心呢？出离心就是说啊，下决心啊，我一定要成就啊，我一定要解脱啊，我一定要超越这个生老病死啊。我学佛不是为了健康长寿发财，而是为了解脱啊。我一定要为了解脱而修行，或者是说，我的修心一定要为了解脱，为了从这个生老病死的痛苦当中摆脱啊啊，这样子的决心啊，就叫做出离心。
What renunciation does entail is the very strong resolve to be liberated from the cyclic.Or the sufferings of cyclic existence, to transcend cyclic existence. It is a firm resolve that is oriented to attaining Buddhahood, to attaining liberation.
出离心啊，我们汉传佛教、藏传佛教、南传佛教都需要的。如果没有出离心的话，那么根本就不叫啊。大乘佛教连小乘佛教都不是。
So regardless whether it's Chinese Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, or the southern traditions of Buddhism, renunciation is equally vital. Without renunciation, then we don't satisfy the level of the Mahayana teachings or even the Hinayana teachings.
小乘佛教或者是南传佛教，它的基础就是出离心，就像大乘佛教的基础是菩提心啊，同样的，小乘佛教的基础是出离心。但是这个出离心呢，不仅仅是小乘佛教，大乘佛教也需要出离心。所以我们真的想学佛啊，这样子的话，真的想解脱的话，那我们要从出离心开始一步一步的去学，一步一步的去修。
So just as bodhicitta is the foundation of the Mahayana teachings, renunciation is the foundation of the Hinayana or Theravada teachings. Having said this, renunciation, its cultivation, is equally important whether it be for Theravada practice or Mahayana practice. So it's by cultivating renunciation that we should begin our study of Buddhism.
然后有了出离心以后呢，啊，我们的学佛的目标已经是明确了啊。我们不管是烧香也好，拜佛也好，这一切的目标是什么呢？就是为了解脱，而不是为了健康 不是为了发财，不是为了工作顺利，只是为了解脱。这个时候呢，我们的学佛的这个目标已经是很明确了。
Once we have generated renunciation, then our goal in Buddhist practice will be extremely clearly defined. Our objective will be is now to attain liberation from cyclic existence. No longer is it worldly benefits such as fame, wealth, or prosperity in this existence.
那我们刚才讲的这些我们实际上怎么样去落实呢？我们怎么去学习呢？怎么去修心呢？怎么去打坐呢？就是比如说我们比如说墨尔本这个本地的情况我不是很了解，这个地方可能有藏传佛教的中心，也有汉传佛教的中心有佛教的中心的话，那么就是应该有这个佛教的中心当中应该有一些汉传佛教的法师，还有就是藏传佛教的堪布呀等等，应该有一个主持的人。那么作为一个主持的人的话，他是应该知道怎么样去学，知道怎么样去修那这样子的话，我们应该勤转发论，意思就是说我们让他们请求他们来给我们传法，给我们这个教学那这样子的话，当地如果有的话就是这个方法，我们可以要求他们用佛教的话来讲，这叫做请转法轮请求他们来给我们转法轮我们不知道怎么去学习，我们不知道怎么去修心，我们一无所知，请你们来指导我们这叫做请转法轮。
Completely sure about the situation in Melbourne. I'd imagine that there are some Tibetan Dharma centers and some Chinese Buddha Dharma centers too. And if these centers have teachers residing there, then presumably these teachers are well informed about the study and practice of Buddhism. And if this is the case, then what we should do is request these teachers to turn the wheel of the Dharma teachings, that is to enlighten us to the meaning of the Dharma and how to go about its practice.
比如说念佛的法门，就是净土宗，是一个非常非常好的一个法门非常好的法门。但是如果我们没有正知正见，念佛法的一个基本的这个理知识都不懂的话呢，那我们在学念佛的过程当中会产生很多很多的疑问，会产生很多很多的烦恼。那么这个时候呢，我们解决不了这些问题的时候，找不到一个合理的答案的时候呢，念佛也念不下去所以念佛的人净土宗也要有一定的学习的基础，也要有一定的问思的基础。
Pure Land practice, for example, is an extremely wonderful, a wonderful path, a path that involves reciting the Amitabha Buddha's name. However, without the most basic foundation of study in the Dharma, then it is highly likely in the course of one's Pure Land practice that doubts will emerge, questions will arise, and that without finding satisfying answers to these questions, one's practice will be impacted on. So even practitioners of the Pure Land School also need to have an appropriate level of understanding of the Dharma.
如果你们的比如说我们念佛的或者是其他的这个佛教的团体，你们的师父你们的上师不在本地的话也是没有关系的，我们现在通过网络全球都可以直播的，所以你们比如说你们的师父如果在台湾或者是在其他地方那这样子的话，那么我们请求他们通过网络给我们传授这些佛教的知识。
If you belong to Buddhist communities where your teacher does not live in Melbourne but resides overseas, then this isn't a problem. We live in an age where internet and such related technology is very advanced. So what students in this situation can do is request their teachings to turn the wheel of the Dharma where they are and transmit the teachings online.
我们的师父或者上师，不管是在台湾也好，在泰国也好，在西藏也好，在美国也好，现在就是这个年代，已经是没有什么距离。我们通过这个网络，随时都可以开一个佛教的一个非常好的学习的课程。
In this day and age, it doesn't matter if one's teacher is in Taiwan, in Thailand, in Tibet, or in America. Using the internet, it's quite possible for us to organize very effective Dharma study courses.
然后我们通过网络学习了以后呢，然后比如说你们自己的这个道场里面，大家集中，比如说每周一次或者两次，每周一次，两次可能不太先是，每周一次，大家聚在一起，聚在一起以后，然后我们在这一周当中所学到的东西，分享给大家，然后大家讨论交流分享，同时呢。 监督、相互鼓励，这样子的话，让我们的很多的疑问，也就是我们自己交流的过程当中，可以找到答案。And
after having listened to teachings online, the thing to do would be to organize face-to-face small group classes at a center such as this. Once a week, and this would provide an excellent opportunity for fellow students of the Dharma to get together, to share what they've learned, to ask questions, resolve doubts, and monitor each other, encourage each other.
如果在这个过程当中，我们交流的过程、讨论的过程当中，实在是大家都没有办法解决这个问题、这个疑问。 都大家都没有办法结伙这样子的话，那么我们可以通过网络，可以问大家的上师和师父、法师，那这个是一点问题都没有，很容易的事情。And
if in the course of discussions students are unable to resolve certain questions they have, then at that time these questions can be put to teachers living overseas if they are via the internet. This doesn't constitute a problem whatsoever.
然后我们的师父、法师给我们的作用是什么呢？就是让我们就学会，让我们知道怎么去学，怎么去修，怎么去做，仅此而已。剩下来的工作是要自己去完成的。
What the role of our teachers and instructors is to provide us with an understanding of how to go about practicing the teachings. Everything beyond this is up to us. The actual implementation is something we have to take care of.
然后呢，修行就是个人的事情，这个没有办法，别人是帮不上的。 还是要靠自己，但是呢，比如说我们一个，比如说像这个道场，它有他们自己的信徒，然后呢，这些信徒每一周就在这个地方大家一起打坐，大家一起修心、共修讨论这样子的话，每一个人都有帮助然后呢，其他的，比如说其他的佛教的小团体。 那么每周他们自己聚在一起，如果没有这样子的道场的话，那么聚在某一位师兄的家里也是可以的，七个人、八个人、十个人聚在一起大家共修、打坐，不影响他们的家庭的生活的情况下聚在一个人的家里去打坐，每天每周就这样子的共修的时间。 一个小时到两个小时，甚至三四个小时，这样子每个人都有收获的。
So even though practice is something that relies on the individual, it's not something that anyone else can do for you, nevertheless, getting together and practicing in group situations is very beneficial. So for example, students getting together in this space, studying the Dharma, practicing together, or students of other Dharma networks gathering together in each other's or in a particular person's house, meeting once a week for a few hours, studying, practicing, etc. This is something that can be very beneficial.
然后修寒川佛教的禅宗啊，修禅宗的人，禅宗和密宗都是我们刚刚讲过，是一个佛教里面的最高端的啊课程。那么这个最高端的课程，我们要去接受这个课程，那它是有条件的，条件是必须要根基成熟啊。如果我们没有做这些基础的东西啊，这些基础的课程都没有去做，直接去修禅，直接去修密啊，这样子的话，那就是悬在高空当中，上不去，下不来啊。最后就是没有任何的结果，会有这样子的问题。
But in respect of the advanced teachings of the Chan and Vajrayana traditions, there are conditions or preconditions that we first need to satisfy. It's necessary that we have appropriate foundations. Immediately going straight to these teachings will lead to a situation where we become stranded in midair, not able to go up and not able to go down either.
处理心啊，修好了以后啊，这个如果是用藏传佛教的方式去修的话，那就是有四个加行，是非常具体的思维的方式，很清楚的啊。然后呢，网上也有很多很多的学习的资料可以学修处理心。
So in respect of the first thing we need to work on cultivating renunciation.There is a concrete practice in the Tibetan preliminary practices, the four thoughts that turn the mind from samsara.
然后这个处理心修好了以后，第二步就修菩提心啊。这个时候我们首先要确定啊，我要解脱，然后呢，再深入、再进一步的确定我要解脱。但是呢，不仅仅是我要解脱，我要让。所有人解脱啊！我如果不管所有人的这个解脱，我只是我一个人解脱啊，那么这个叫做小乘佛教，不叫大乘佛教。我一个人解脱还不够啊啊！这个我要让天下的所有的人要解脱，所以我要努力啊，所以我要修心。这样子的时候呢，这个叫做菩提心。那么菩提心啊，在藏传佛教里面呢，也有非常非常。啊，具体的思维的方式啊，有很多思维的模式啊，已经是模式化，已经是非常规范化、模式化啊。藏传佛教里面都非常的清楚的。如果学藏传佛教的这个方法可以的啊，如果是学其他的方法也是可以的。反正我们总而言之，最终需要的就是这个结果。如果有了这个结果。那这个过程是不是很重要的
？So after having cultivated renunciation, we need to go on to the second step, which is cultivating bodhicitta. Having established the aspiration to achieve liberation, we need to then extend this aspiration to all beings. So our aspiration is not just to achieve liberation ourselves. This is the scope of motivation of theof the modest vehicle. As students of the Mahayana teachings, it's necessary that our motivation be larger, that we be oriented to achieving the enlightenment and liberation of all beings. And it's in respect of generating bodhicitta that the Tibetan tradition is equipped with a wealth of concrete meditational practices that students can practice.However, ultimately, whether or not one is a student of the Tibetan tradition or of another tradition, the goals that we need to satisfy are first the generation of renunciation and then secondly, bodhicitta.
还有我们搞慈善慈善非常的重要，我们佛教徒在这个方面呢比较欠缺我们应该去搞这个慈善。这个佛讲的六度里面的第一度就是布施，慈善是相当相当重要的。但是我们佛教它的特长就不是搞慈善也不是这个给予物质。给予物质当然对很多人来说是非常非常重要的，我们不能忽略，我们尽可能的尽量的去应该去投入这个工作当中。但是呢佛教要给予大家的是什么？不是物质，而是精神上的智慧和慈悲。所以呢我们还是要慈善，我们要去做，但是我们更加的需要强调内在的精神上的修行。
So in respect of charity, charity is something that is very important and something that we as Buddhists should engage in. It's something that the Buddhist tradition has at times been quite lacking in. And indeed, generosity is the first of the six paramitas. However, we also need to understand that the highest form of charity is not in fact material charity, or rather that it is not material charity that is the distinguishing feature of the Buddhist tradition. In fact, the Buddhist tradition places or has as its strong point wisdom and compassion and the ability to benefit others through this. So it's for this reason that Buddhist practice is in fact more important here.
然后出离心和菩提心这些修完了以后呢，最后一个修法就叫做修空心，这个就是修金刚经和般若心经当中的内容，就修空心。用禅宗的话来讲，这叫做明心见性。
And after we have successfully cultivated renunciation and bodhicitta, the next thing for us to do is to work on developing a correct understanding or correct view of emptiness. We are cultivating the wisdom of the Diamond Sutra, the Wisdom Sutras. What this is referring to, using a Chan expression, is understanding the basic nature of our minds.
用藏传佛教的密宗的话来讲，就是证悟大圆满。
Or in the Dzogchen teachings of the Vajrayana tradition, to understand or obtain an understanding, a realization of great perfection.
我们每一个人都有生之年每一个人都有机会发菩提心成为一个菩萨，然后呢每一个人都有机会证悟空心，明心见性。
Every single person has the potential to generate bodhicitta and become a bodhisattva. Likewise, everyone has the potential to realize emptiness and obtain enlightenment.
我们应该好好的珍惜这个机会，我们要争取有生之年临终之前能够发起菩提心，能够证悟空心能够明心见性。
Everyone should really cherish this opportunity that we have and strive before the moment of death to generate bodhicitta and arrive at an understanding of or a realization of emptiness and an understanding of the nature of mind.
这个就是作为我们作为一个佛教徒，就是我们的人生的目标，我们的生命的意义。
As a Buddhist, this is essentially the purpose in our lives, the meaning, the greater meaning in our existence.
希望大家以后我们重新投入到这个文思秀的这个珍贵的佛教的道路上希望每一个人都能够有收获。
I sincerely hope that from this point onwards, everybody really invests or reinvests in the study, reflection, and practice of Buddhism, and that everyone reaps excellent results of their endeavors.
好，今天我们的讲座到此结束，非常感谢，阿弥陀佛。
Sonumda yi tamca zirba ni domne ni pe jane barji Kirga na je valon jepa Chibin zole jowa dhuva sho Om ahom banzirangar pamasada Om ahom banzirangar pamasada Om Aum Bandrungur Bama Sada